The president has just laid out his economic vision for America, offered a deal to the Republicans. I'll cut corporate tax rates if you'll close corporate tax loopholes. Very interesting stuff. Peter Ferrara has been writing about President Obama over at Forbes.com. Peter is a senior fellow with the Carlson Center for Public Policy, the author of America's Ticking Bankruptcy Bomb, the website theccpp.org, ccpp.org. I have that right, Peter?
Yes.
Welcome back.
Glad to be here.
Thank you. Your last article I found really interesting, and I just genuinely wanted to ask you about this. You start out by talking about how Obama is, you say, the magician's trick is deception. Obama's deceiving us. In his economic policy speech last week at Knox College in Galesville, Illinois, you say he talks a lot about championing the middle class, a ploy he learned from Saul Alinsky, which is a vaguely Russian-sounding name or maybe a Jewish-sounding name or something. I guess it's supposed to be sinister. And then for Barack Obama, you write, the whole purpose of his public life is to foist the leftist ideology of his father on a mesmerized American public. This is what you were writing at Forbes. Really?
Yes.
And tell me about it.
That's obvious, but he's governing on an Americanized version of Marxism. He's taking it as far as he possibly can in the American system, and he's doing a very good job of it if you're a communist. But he's not interested in the middle class. He said in his speech, he's for good jobs, quote, good jobs, a better bargain for the middle class and folks working to join it, an economy that grows from the middle out.
Right.
Well, where's that been for 5 years as president?
It's been obstructed by Republicans.
We have middle class income declining for the entire time Obama's been president.
Mm-hmm.
Middle class incomes are down the equivalent of a month's pay a year.
Yep, Eric Cantor, Paul Ryan, yes.
Instead of good jobs, America's under transition to part-time jobs.
Yep, Mitch McConnell.
The number of full-time jobs actually declined. All the new jobs created last month were part-time jobs.
Kevin
McCarthy. No wonder middle-class incomes are declining, because you can't earn a good income with just a part-time job.
Yeah, Pete Hoekstra.
Instead of an economy growing from the middle out, we've had under Obama for 5 years now, an economy that has effectively not been growing at all.
Pete Sessions, yes.
Pete Sessions is not president.
No, well, there on the night that the president was inaugurated, there were 14 Republicans who got together: Paul Ryan, Eric Cantor, Kevin McCarthy, Pete Sessions, Jeb Hensling, Pete Hoekstra, Dan Lundgren, Jim DeMint, John Kyle, Tom Coburn, John Ensign, and Bob Corker at the Caucus Room Restaurant here in Washington, D.C., and they plotted a plan that has been written about in several books now to stop this president from having any kind of economic success during his presidency. And in fact, one of their members, Kevin McCarthy, said, we've got to challenge them on every single bill, show united and unyielding opposition to the president's economic policies. He said that on the record. And another one, Congressman Pete Sessions, said, we're understanding this from the Taliban. This is a Taliban insurgency. We need to understand that insurgency is required when dealing with the other side. We will become the Taliban insurgency. The insurgency is a mindset.
That must have been a very interesting meeting, because on the night President Obama was inaugurated, the Republicans had exactly zero power.
I know.
In Congress.
I know.
And they were
plotting how to get it back, and they did a very, very good job.
Well,
so
really,
so you're saying that it's President Obama's communism and Marxism that has caused the economy to be in the crapper for 5 years. I would think if he was really a communist or a Marxist, he would nationalize some of our industries. Like, you know, just take ExxonMobil, for example, and you know, the hundreds of billions in profits that they make, nationalize it, like many countries have done. I mean, Norway did this, right? And nationalize it and say, this is now the property of the people, or semi-nationalize it the way that Sarah Palin did up in Alaska, where you say, you know, we're going to tax you fairly heavily on all that oil you take out of the ground. And every year, you know, as you, I'm sure you know, Sarah Palin wrote a check to every single citizen in Alaska, whether they were 2 years old or 102 years old, a check for a little over $2,000 out of oil revenues. Why isn't he doing that kind of stuff? Because that would provide an immediate stimulus.
Smart socialists know that you don't need to nationalize anything anymore. You just take it over by regulation. So mm-hmm. He's already done that with the healthcare industry. He's already done that with the financial industry. He's already done that with much of the energy industry, and so he's making his progress that way. But well, if policy he's followed has been anti-growth. Higher tax rates, more regulation, increased government spending, deficits and debt, and a weak dollar monetary policy. That's four proponents guaranteed. If we follow that, America will be Argentina in a matter of time. It's just a matter of time.
Well, it would take a military dictator to make us Argentina. Or you mean contemporary Argentina, which is doing quite well right now. Thank you very much.
Okay, well, you know, if
you meant Argentina 2000.
Well, I mean, the AFL-CIO folks can just go to Argentina. That's great, because we don't prevent them from doing that. So if you think Argentina is doing great.
Well, there are a lot of cooperatives.
It's a country with a very poor standard of living, and that's where we're going if we continue to follow these anti-growth policies.
Well, I think they're doing great compared to where they've been and compared to some of the countries around them. But I still don't get the communist part. And in fact, you wrote about this. You said, the truth is Obama disdains economic growth in the middle class. What he treasures is the neediness of government dependency. That, you know, presumably because more people are on food stamps and unemployment now than ever before, that's what you're talking about. Do I have that right, Peter?
He's taking the Chicago political machine model national. So he wants government dependency so he can trade government handouts for votes. And
right.
So that is why food stamps has been run up so much. That's why Medicaid is being run up so much. He wants people dependent on the government. He wants as many people on welfare as possible because he figures if you're on welfare, the Democrat Party owns you and you will vote Democrat for the rest of your life. And
okay. Okay, I understand that. After the last Republican great crash in 1929, you know, through the 1930s, Franklin Roosevelt came along and he did exactly what you're saying. He passed out jobs. He hired 12 million people between 1933 and 1940, before World War II. He passed out food. He did exactly what you're describing, and people loved him for it, reelected him over and over again. But as soon as the economy recovered, those people dropped, you know, they quit the CCC and the WPA to go to work for General Motors and Motor Wheel and Chrysler. And I mean, they immediately went to the private sector as soon as there were openings, as soon as the private sector had recovered. Why do you think, how is President Obama going to keep people in chains if the economy does recover and keep them from doing what people did in the 50s?
Well, see, that's exactly my point. See, when they became middle class, they became Republicans. And now you see that all over the world. The middle class is politically independent because they're financially independent. But under Obama's policies, it's not going to recover. That sense, the headline of my column, there's a boom in this economy lurking at the end of Obama's second term. Because every policy he's followed is anti-growth. High tax rate, increased government regulation, weak dollar monetary policies, roaring government spending, deficits and debt. And so it's all discouraging to the economy, and it you're not going to have economic growth as long as you're following that. And you've got now 5 years
And yet,
of that.
At the same time,
the
these things
recovery,
are...
The data shows a weaker recovery than for any other recovery since the Great Depression.
Paul Ryan, Eric Cantor. Yes, I agree. And the Republicans are doing a very good job of blocking everything he's tried to do. I'm totally with you.
One policy that would have created jobs that the Republicans...
And I agree with you that when he leaves office...
Yeah.
If the Republicans stop obstructing him, if they go back to like when George Bush was president and just start saying, hey, let's go on a spending spree, or like when Ronald Reagan was president, you're going to see an economic boom. I agree with you.
There's not one policy that would have created jobs that the Republicans have stopped. Not one.
Okay. How about his jobs bill that they're filibustering?
They already did that. That was, they did the stimulus bill, and come back and do half as much again.
No, I mean,
that's a good idea.
Okay.
It's not worthy of a president of the United States.
Peter, we're running out of time here. Thank you for dropping by theccpp.org. Thank you, Peter. Peter Ferrara.
This is the Thom Hartmann Program.
So, Obama, Kenyan socialists? Maybe? But I don't know how it's going to work long term.